stories shaping our world for 2020.
And it's a bit of a homecoming for years of teaching. Used to be the morning anchor for years, grew up watching you, not to date you or anything.
Well, that's all right.
I always look forward to Dr. Garris because she would say whenever those schools would be closed, you made my day.
Here we are, making you go to school all the time.
Yeah. Well, let's get started right now for this special edition. We opened up this year with a controversy over a pill sold in a vending machine.
There were scary moments, too, with assaults and a stabbing near campus.
And on a much lighter note, Shippensburg, according to one study, we're a hot spot to have fun.
And you probably had to find your flashlight, too. Blackouts became a part of life on campus, most recently last night.
So let's take a look back at the big stories we brought you this year on SUTV News.
A promo came on CNN, and they were going to talk about a university was selling Plan B in a vending machine. I went, oh, gosh.
Voted for by the Student Senate 3 years ago, funding for this vending machine does not come from tuition fees or taxpayer dollars.
Students waited for the long haul to Harrisburg. Signs were made, slogans created, and pep talks given.
We're really thrilled that you're here.
But as the buses rolled out, the only sound was a simple message for Governor Corbett.
No more cuts! No more cuts!
It may have looked and felt different a year ago, but 2012 protesters say the smaller crowd isn't a quieter one.
There's more energy this year. People are more angry.
I think there's a lot of enthusiasm this year from people to get out and see.
While cars on Earl Street whip past the quiet apartment area, according to this Shippensburg University text alert Saturday night, it was a different story. It warned students to be on guard after an attempted assault at 35 College Park.
A crazy college idea.
Well, I just decided that I wasn't going anywhere, why not?
To be nationally recognized.
And they said that WIBS was number 9. In top bars.
Check this out. This is the wire to blame, all singed and burned up as thousands of volts of electricity burst through it last night, and it left a lot of you looking for your flashlights.
And it all went dark.
A shooting took place at Sunbeam Court, better known to students as Greek Row. Witnesses say the shot was a result of a fight that broke out over people not being allowed to enter a closed party.
To look back on all of that video, but it's hard to believe how much time flies. I remember seeing that Plan B vending machine on Jay Leno. That's how I first heard about it. It's crazy stuff, but it definitely attracted national attention with that one.
Well, those power outages, too, continue to be a problem. Much of today, the Cub was in the dark, plus a couple of dorms didn't have light this morning. 11 buildings went dark in the blackout last night.
Yeah, those blackouts started this summer. It continued a couple times this semester, and then again, last night, you may have gotten that SU alert or found out the hard way if you didn't click save before it went dark in the library working on a paper. That would be my luck. Well, earlier this fall, I went in search of why these blackouts are happening and found out it's because of old wiring that needs to be replaced. It's causing those problems.
Well, beyond Ship, some presidential election polls suffered power outages in 2012.
Now, Hurricane Sandy hit the East Coast the week before the election. We had classes canceled here at Ship, but it didn't cancel the election. Some voters actually had to phone in their votes.
Yep, and among the issues for voters, health care, the economy, and women's rights. And Kyle, you could say it was the year of the woman.
Indeed, SUTV's Sarah Small joins us in the studio right now with how women broke records and boundaries on the night of November 6th. Sarah.
What once was deemed the war on women became the year of women. According to CNN exit polls of the voting population, 53% were women. Rutgers Center for American Women in Politics reports 296 women filed to run for the House this year, shattering the 2010 record of 262 women. Medicare and reproductive rights were hot issues in the election, but may not have been the only.
Patterns of education and employment. I think there's a critical tipping point where as you get a population of women who are more educated and are out in well-paid careers, then women are thinking about other options.
Female candidates played a huge role in the election, and female voters did as well. With education comes more tolerance.
America is moving forward, and there are going to definitely, and there still are a lot of people angry at the election results, but there are a lot of key pull points from that.
Wisconsin's Tammy Baldwin, being the first elected openly gay senator, shows people care more about the issues of public interest than the elector's personal preferences.
Shows that the people in Wisconsin are really open to thinking about not the person's sexuality, not the person's gender, not the person's race, but they're open to the idea that we want someone who can govern and represents our ideas.
We now have a record-breaking 20 women in the Senate. So what does that mean for the future of our country? And why did this take so long?
Well, I think as the women are showing that they are capable, and some of these women become national leaders in the Senate, I really think that that bodes well for other female candidates.
America is leaps and bounds behind other countries when it comes to female leaders.
America's only been around for almost 200 years, so I think we have an evolution to do as well.
2012 is proved to be the year of the woman, and from here, it only gets better.
Women make up 51% of the population and 56% of voters, yet only 17% of Congress is female. And that falls far behind many other countries, ranking 78th, behind 95 other countries. As women grow in Congress, so does our country. But if women don't run, women can't win. Back to you at the desk.
Sarah, thank you. It was also the year of scandal of national prominence right here in Pennsylvania.
Happy Valley was anything but after a coach scarred the stellar reputation of a football program and a community. He went from spending his life coaching along the sidelines to facing life behind bars.
Moments before, Jerry Sandusky heard of his verdict. Guilty. It was a high-profile trial in this Bellefonte courtroom, stemming from a grand jury report saying he had used his Second Mile Foundation to molest young boys.
They can take away my life. They can make me out as a monster, they can treat me as a monster, but they can't take away my heart. In my heart, I know I did not do these alleged disgusting acts. My wife has been my only sex partner, and that was after marriage.
He was sentenced to 30 to 60 years behind bars, and victims found justice.
When my endeavor began, I never imagined how it would turn out. The fear and shame associated with sexual abuse can ruin someone. And I hope that I can help other victims to have a voice.
Fallout continued from other administrators charged with concealing the crime. Head football coach Joe Paterno was fired. He soon after died. A legacy disturbed by the Sandusky scandal, his famed statue removed. A football team now facing several penalties, and a university paying the first of five $12 million fines. A year these students won't soon forget.
Sandusky remains behind bars at Green State Prison in southwestern Pennsylvania. The Associated Press reports he's hoping to go to a new prison where it's less restrictive.
In the first edition of Time magazine from this year, writers made predictions for the year ahead, so we thought it would be interesting to see how successful they were. First, writers said they expect wild weather, and we can't disagree with them. Superstorm Sandy knocked right at our door. Also, the magazine predicted the name Sophia would be the most popular name for a baby girl. And looking back, the Social Security Administration said it was. One year can change a person's life.
And one year can give a person life. For the last several months, SUTV's Amanda Peterson has followed the journey of Dr. Becky Overholt.
She is an education professor here at SU and recovering from a bone marrow transplant. Amanda caught up with her this week and has an update, and we found Amanda. Amanda?
There's Amanda.
Thanks, Kim and Kyle. And after an overseas vacation in the summer of 2011, Overholt returned to feeling under the weather. After beating breast cancer just years prior, she did not expect to face another life-threatening disease so soon.
Oh, there's my favorite doctor.
This told her that they did a YouTube.
Even during trying times, Becky Overholt is always wearing a smile. The last year has been a time where smiles should have been hard to come by. Just 10 months ago, Dr. Becky Overholt's office walls turned into an inpatient room at Johns Hopkins. Becky was diagnosed with myelodysplastic syndrome in 2011, but this disease would not end Becky's life.
The doctor looked at me and she said, the good news is this is curable.
So Becky was put on the National Bone Marrow Registry, and on the Saturday before Christmas, she found a match.
So it was like a Christmas present.
In January, Becky became a patient at Johns Hopkins. And February 1st, she had her transplant.
The further you get away from the transplant without the disease coming back, the better your odds are.
After 31 days, Becky entered inpatient, outpatient care.
They give you fluids, they give you medicines, they check your blood every day. They just do everything they would do for you in the hospital, but you get to go home and sleep.
4 months after the procedure, Becky returned home. And in August, she returned to work.
I teach two classes, supervise five student teachers, and then have head up the middle level program committee.
The first few months back were not easy.
At first, it was really hard. I would teach class and go back to my office and just kind of almost fall apart.
Now, 10 months later, Becky's life is almost normal.
I've had to have frequent biopsies in that first year, bone marrow biopsies, and they've all come back that I'm 100% donor.
She misses working as the principal of Grace B. Lores Elementary School, but visits with the students often.
Dr. Overholt plans to return as the director of Grace B. Lores Elementary School in the fall of 2013. Right now, she hopes to continue getting stronger and enjoy teaching during the spring semester. Back to you, Kim.
Thanks, Amanda. It's been a busy year for us all, but a Shippensburg University custodian and a student have literally published a new chapter in their lives.
Donna Riley has the custodial routine down to a science. No messy trash can is safe on her watch. She's alert to the little details required to keep a big building clean. Her focus on the small stuff has meant success at this job and at telling stories good enough to publish.
A bee talk to your memes? Ask Ariana. Why, yes.
Donna found the little character who inspired this story when she was camping last summer.
This huge, big, black and yellow bee flew into my camp. And it was just buzzing me and buzzing me and buzzing me.
She recognized the opportunity to tell children stories of faith and God's presence.
And I got to thinking, you know, he wasn't there. He wasn't there to see me. He wasn't there to bother me. He was there doing what God had put in him. He was there to look for food to take back to his bee family.
And a publisher recognized her bee as a story people would buy.
Donna, he says, we can publish this. Well, I just about had a stroke. I was so excited.
But then she had a problem. She had written a children's book, but couldn't do pictures.
Every stroke of her hair.
Shippensburg University student Shayna Arnold could.
I would probably.
And did.
We went through the script together, and she kind of told me like what she wanted on each page, and then I just brought it to life.
For months, Shayna worked to capture the smallest details of Donna's book. And like the little bee, Shayna fit well into Donna's story.
She and I worked together so well, so very well. She has free rein to do whatever she wants.
And I feel like we're on the same page. Like, she tells me what she wants, and then I do it, and she loves it, and then we move on to the next page, and so on and so forth.
And the next page has now turned into their next book, the second of five Donna has written with the same successful formula. Good news for their readers. And for Jesus.
So I would do rough pictures and send them to her to give her an idea. And in the second one, we had I have Jesus in there talking to the disciples. Well, Jesus looks like a stick figure. And when she did that, I said, I'm really glad you put some meat on Jesus' bones.
So I definitely fixed that.
And surely the next three books will hold similar challenges to Shayna. But it's work she embraces.
I like her ideas. They're really neat. How she just brings all this stuff into this nice little moral story. It's just amazing.
Like the cleaning work always there for Donna, so too are her ideas for stories. She's got an idea for one more. And who knows? She may just find the inspiration for her next book buzzing along these halls.
Hi there.
Hi there.
And you can buy Donna's first book, Believe Me, God Has a Plan for You, online through Amazon and Barnes & Noble. The book is getting great reviews, and Donna's goal is to sell enough books online, the publisher will place it on actual store shelves.
I love that. Great story. Well, everybody loves a compliment, whether it's about your smile or your hair, which your hair looks lovely today.
Yes,
she actually brushed it. But in a virtual world where cyberbullying is common, one girl who's relatively new to campus wants to make it better. One Facebook status at a time, and keeping in the theme of the online mystery, this complimenter is staying confidential.
We live in a connected world, and it's all about the likes. But when she opens up her computer,
I'm a freshman,
and logs onto Facebook,
not very many people know that I do this.
Her inbox is filled with compliments.
Lavel Simpkins is one of the nicest guys I've met here.
But they aren't about her.
Having people that care about you send in nice things about you is just, it's nice.
It's pretty simple. All you have to do is just write out your compliment and then send it to Shippensburg Compliments. And from there, she'll post it. It's an idea she got from other colleges across the country.
What we wanted to do is just bring it over here, have our students be able to take part in this type of social media.
And now with over 1,000 friends in less than a month,
maybe people will learn to be more open to each other.
Emily Troop liked her compliment.
Says, Emily Troop is a loyal and devoted friend who goes out of her way to help people. She always has something clever or funny to say.
When Jimmy Thread read his shout out,
but to see someone do it for me and have no idea who did it for me, I mean, that was absolutely incredible.
As far as revealing who she is,
anonymity is best.
Whoever it is absolutely incredible for keeping it so quiet, you know, and keeping it all about the site and not them.
I think it's a cute idea. I mean, it only helps to boost morale, especially during finals week.
And she hopes to make your day as she goes on her way.
And while her idea is bringing plenty of likes, there's a chance Facebook could shut down her account because Shippensburg Compliments is not a real person. And because of all of the recent friend requests she sends and receives, for now though, the confidential complimenter tells me she'll worry about that if it happens. Until then, she's busy hearing all of the good things about you.
I'd
and
like
to whoever complimented me on that, I appreciate it.
I'd like to
nice.
Compliment her.
Yeah, isn't
very
that awesome?
Very nice, yeah. All right, still to come, your graduation day forecast.
Plus, some of the biggest viral videos of the year. Do you know how to Gangnam Style? Come on, something
no,
like
I'm
this.
No, I'm not doing it. I told you I wasn't.
It was worth a try. Your full entertainment wrap-up is coming up.
And on a more serious note, we'll look back at those we lost this year. We'll be right back.